Have you or a loved one recently been arrested for a serious crime?
Is your professional reputation at risk?
Aggressive representation from a qualified defense attorney can help you avoid conviction and keep your reputation untarnished.
Hi, I'm Charles McGill, and I'll fight for your rights. With extensive experience in successfully defending against a wide range of criminal offenses and high-profile cases, you can rest assured that you'll get the fair trial you deserve from McGill Guzman McGill. Call us at 559-255-3425 or visit us online at toplawyer.com.
For KitchenAid innovation and quality. Who has the answers, the selection, the price? Ventura TV Appliance. With billions in nationwide appliance buying power, more than Home Depot and Best Buy combined, we'll help you save. Our low prices on Energy Star qualified KitchenAid appliances save you energy and money, and pay no interest on select models when paid in full within 12 months. Ventura TV Appliance, serving you since 1951.
Hi, I'm John Malos. Welcome to this live edition of Connect With Me on the showroom floor at Ventura TV on this day. Hey, today's a special day. We're talking about water releases out of Millerton, out of San Luis, and other places. So call in and weigh in. We'll have a guest on the telephone from Sacramento to talk about this. And later in the program, a guest right here in the studio. 436-ME-TV, option 11. Charles Chuck McGill is our sponsor on the program today. Back in a moment. Okay, welcome back to the program here. Having some technical difficulties, so we're on camera two over here. As you can see, my guest in the studio here is Roger George. We'll get to him later on, but first, we got to take a phone call here because our topic today, our main topic, is the water releases out of Millerton Lake and San Luis. Maybe you saw this in the Fresno Bee just recently here. They are making a lot of water releases. We have gotten a lot of rain. We are above normal. The snowpack, of course, is at its normal level right now. So the snowpack, I think, is just starting to melt. On April, just after April 1st, it starts little by little by little, slow but sure. Live on the telephone, I want to get right to it, is Shane Hunt. He is the Public Affairs Officer for the Bureau of Reclamation. There is his picture up on the screen right there. He is live from Sacramento. Good morning, Shane. Good to have you on the program. How are you?
Good morning. I'm good.
Good. Hey, let me ask you just first of all, just directly, a lot of releases coming out of both Millerton and San Luis the last 10 days. In fact, Millerton has gone down by 7 feet during that time period. Why the releases now that we have all this water that's come down the last 3 months and we're not saving any of it? And the releases are going on right now because why?
The majority of the releases from Millerton right now are actually going to farmers, water users off the Fryant, Kern, and Madera canals. There is some water going down the river for the contractors that have water rights just below the dam and a little bit of water for the San Joaquin River Restoration Program, but the vast majority of the releases are going to agricultural districts.
Okay, so they're going to agriculture. That water that's being released is not going down into the Pacific Ocean?
No, not at all. None of the water from Millerton is actually making it to the ocean. Yesterday, we released about 330 CFS into the river. Quite a bit of that, at least half of that, goes to riparian users off the river between Millerton and Gravelly Ford. A little over 800 CFS was going up the Madera Canal north, and about 3,800 CFS was going down the Fryant-Kern Canal south. Both the canal deliveries are for ag users.
Okay, but it is alarming to a lot of people to see the fact that we've got so much rain, and we're not out of the woods yet. There's no question about that. You know, we've gotten above normal rain the last 3 months or so. Who knows how much more it's going to rain, especially after April the 1st. There's a big storm brewing. I think for the next 3 days, we're expecting rain in the Central Valley. El Nino has kind of fizzled out a little bit. It's not as big a punch as we thought it was. Northern California got a lot more rain than Central California and certainly in Southern California. So in a lot of people's mind, they're going, gee, why are you releasing so much water? And the second part of that question is there any chance that a lot of this water, especially when the snowpack starts to melt, is there any chance the Bureau can store it somewhere? Is there a storage area?
There's significant amount of storage in reservoirs upstream of Millerton. There's more water in storage upstream in the basin than there is capacity to store water in Millerton, and there's still quite a bit of capacity to store more upstream. We're making most of the releases right now to make sure that we can manage the snowmelt when it does come down. It's been pretty warm the last few days, and we're forecasted to have quite a bit of snow melt come down into the reservoir over the next couple of months. So that's what you're seeing happen right now.
So when the snow starts to come down in water form and it starts melting in rapid fashion, do you plan to raise those water levels up in both San Luis and Millerton?
The water level will come up in Millerton. San Luis is a different story. The water that goes into San Luis is exported out of the Delta. That's mainly Northern California water. And during April and May, you're going to see San Luis come down some because we're pretty export constrained right now.
Okay. Not going to sit well with the fishermen, though.
No.
But... okay, keep him up. Go ahead and crank that up there, Marcus. All right, let me read you an editorial out of the Fresno Bee just recently here. The state needs 3 years of above average precipitation to recover and far more than that to restore depleted aquifers. It also needs more storage, underground and above ground, including the long planned sites reservoir in Colusa and Glenn counties, additional recycling and probably more of the same in those areas. Would you agree with that assessment?
I agree with the basic tenets of that, yeah. I mean, the water deficit created over the drought is significant, and the first step in kind of recovering from that is the reservoirs have to come up, which we've seen happen, at least in Northern California, more than down in the Fresno area, and start getting some people off of the groundwater that they've been using because surface supplies have been so constrained so that groundwater can start to recover. In addition, you know, we've got to employ those strategies like improving storage above and below, you know, small scale, large scale, whatever that might be from, you know, the policymakers. But water recycling is a good thing. Improving conservation is always a good thing.
The water is going out of San Luis. Where is that water ending up?
San Luis Reservoir is a joint federal-state facility, so some of that water is being delivered to state water project contractors, and then some of that water is going to federal contractors, including the exchange contractors in the middle of the valley.
Do you foresee this problem in the next 2 or 3 years as we try to get out of this drought? We can't predict the future. We don't have a crystal ball. We don't know how much rain we're going to get next year or the following year or the year after that. But it's a delicate balance as to how much water to keep. Because what if we're in a drought the next 2 years? Is there enough water to sustain us?
We're setting in a much better situation than we have been for the last couple of years, but it's still, you know, questionable what's going to happen next year. Most of our reservoirs are fairly small compared to the runoff. It's not the same as, say, Hoover on the Colorado River, where you could store a couple years' worth of the total runoff of the Colorado River and the two big reservoirs on the Colorado. We don't have that luxury with most of our reservoirs here.
Let me ask you just a couple more questions here, and we'll let you go. I see Millerton here is about 64% capacity. Is there any chance that the Bureau can keep that a little higher, keep more water in it, and still manage the runoff when it happens?
The lake will come up. It's coming down right now, but it will come back up as the snow starts to melt.
But I'm saying keep it at a higher level until that snow melts and then manage it. Can't you keep that reservoir at 70 or 80% most of the time?
It's pretty small compared to the size of the basin. And as you mentioned, there's quite a bit of snow up on the mountain. So we are trying to regulate that water to use it as best as we can. And in order to do that, we're starting to move water to the water districts that can use it now so that when it does start to come down the mountain, we don't have to make flood releases.
Okay. Why are we sending the extra water from the Delta to San Luis instead of letting it go to sea?
We export as much water as we can under the various requirements that we have, and we try to store as much of it in San Luis for later in the year as we can.
Okay. One final thing. I noticed that some of the dams and the reservoirs up north of us, like Shasta and some of those bigger ones like Oroville Dam, they have more water storage. Obviously, they're bigger, but they also right now have more capacity than our smaller dams like here in the Central Valley. And so why do those dams have more water and we have less water here?
We've seen a very skewed precipitation season where it's been fairly wet north of Sacramento and much drier south of Sacramento. So we're glad to see that we have had good recovery in the big reservoirs in the state like Shasta and Oroville, even to some extent Trinity. But it's just not enough to get us out of this situation.
Yeah, I guess what a lot of people wondering, and some people have asked me this question, why can't the water storage either at Millerton or San Luis be higher like some of the bigger dams up north, and then when that runoff comes in, just manage it and keep it to that level?
Millerton's more like Folsom. It's even smaller than Folsom, but there. The amount of water that can come in when the snow starts to melt is pretty significant. So this is how we operate Millerton. When we know that there's going to be water coming in, we make that water available. The contractors use it. We know that the reservoir is going to get replenished by the snow that will come down and releases from the reservoirs upstream.
So it sounds like Millerton is a little more difficult to manage than some of the other dams because of the size, or what? Am I misreading that?
No, you're pretty much spot on. It's very small compared to the amount of runoff that can come into it during wetter periods.
So that makes it more difficult to manage?
It just means we operate it in a different way.
Can you explain?
We operate it in a way where we've made water available to the contractors and told them, we have this block of water, but you have to take it over a very limited period of time, 6 to 8 weeks, so that we can manage the flows that come into the reservoir. So the districts that can use that to replenish groundwater or put it immediately on the ground for crops, they take that water and put it to use, and that's how the Fryant system works.
Okay, so it's much different than operating Folsom Dam is what you're saying?
Yes.
Okay, well, I appreciate your time very much, and you know, we hope that sometime in the near future we can call on you again when we touch on this subject. I really appreciate you coming on this morning. Thanks for your time.
Sure, no problem. Good to talk to you.
Okay, Shane Hunt is the Public Affairs Officer for the Bureau of Reclamation, joining us live from Sacramento, of course, talking about the water levels, and we'll get into all the details about how much water they're actually releasing out of Millerton and San Luis Reservoir. For all you fishermen, all you boaters out there that are concerned, and all of you people that are concerned that another drought may be hitting the Central Valley, because we don't know what's going to happen the next year or two. We could get a lot of rain. We could be in a drought situation. Only Mother Nature knows for sure. Back after this brief timeout from McGill, Chuck McGill. He is our sponsor today. He is an attorney at law.
Revan is now on KVHF channel 4.4.
Have you or a loved one recently been arrested for a serious crime?
Is your professional reputation at risk?
Aggressive representation from a qualified defense attorney can help you avoid conviction and keep your reputation untarnished.
Hi, I'm Charles McGill, and I'll fight for your rights. With extensive experience in successfully defending against a wide range of criminal offenses and high-profile cases, you can rest assured that you'll get the fair trial you deserve from McGill, Guzman, McGill. Call us at 559-255-3425 or visit us online at toplawyersfresno.com.
After God created the world, he made man and woman. Then, to keep the whole thing from collapsing, he invented humor!
Sub, a perfect reason to rejoice. A distinctly positioned channel in the crowded Hindi general entertainment channel space. It is India's only family comedy entertainment channel with a core brand promise of Asli Maza Sabke Saath Aata Hai.
Dekh raha hu.
Which means celebrate the joy of being together. Taking humor as a universal language, the shows on Sub are light-hearted and make up for an enjoyable family viewing experience. Indeed.
Asli maza.
Asli maza. Sabka saath aata hai.
Ab to sabko pata hai yaar.
Sub TV is now on digital channel 31.8.
Frigidaire. We introduce the first home freezer. The first pulsator agitator washer. And now we introduce the Frigidaire Orbit Clean Dishwasher, designed with a unique wash arm that gives you four times more water coverage for a consistently better clean. Frigidaire, over 90 years of legendary innovation. See the full line of Frigidaire appliances at Ventura TV Electronics and Appliances.
Not sure what you're watching? Want to see what's coming up next? Or just want to browse what's on without the hassle of flipping channels? Your wish has come true. Now you can view schedules for all the digital TV channels available in the Central Valley. Get local weather updates and forecasts, and listen to nationally syndicated Biz Talk Radio, all on KVHF 4.1. Rescan your TV now, then tune in to digital channel 4.1 to start enjoying the all-new TV guide.
Back here on the program, it's time to do our regular monologue now with our regular guest here in the studio. It was a phone call earlier from Shane Hunt. He is the public affairs officer for the Bureau of Reclamation, talking about all those releases. We'll get into that during the course of this program, and you're welcome to call in because Shane is gone now. He's off the telephone, and we have an open line, 436-ME-TV, option 11. So this water thing, boy, you know, anytime you talk about, if you talk about downtown Fresno, we get a lot of calls. You start talking about the stadium and the Grizzlies, we get a lot of calls. You start talking politics, we get a lot of calls. And then, if you start talking water, the phones usually do light up. Does it just make your blood boil? I'm talking about, have we not learned our lesson from the last 4 years or so during this drought? They're making eye-popping amounts of releases out of both San Luis Reservoir and Millerton. Where is all that water going? A lot of it is going out to the farmers, but let's roll the videotape, show you what I'm talking about, my friends. You are looking at Millerton Lake here. Capacity at the moment is only 64%. But with all the rain that we've had the last 3 months, which is well above normal, should Millerton be at a higher level? Well, according to Shane Hunt, no, because it's harder to manage. Should we be storing more of that water instead of releasing it down out of the lake? The answer for some is yes. This is our question of the day here on Connect With Me. According to the National Weather Service, since January, we've had more than 7 inches of rain right here in the Central Valley. That's about an inch above normal. And the rain total for the year, we're up by, we're up to 12.88 inches. The norm is about 11.5. So as you can see, we're slightly above the norm. Yet they're releasing water out of Millerton by the gallons. In fact, since March 29th, the lake has been dropping by a foot a day. In the last 10 days alone, Millerton has dropped by 7 feet. And what that means is the height of the lake has dropped. During the same time period, nearly 33,000 acre feet of water has been released out of Millerton Lake. As for Pine Flat, it's about 40% capacity. Shaver, 57%. San Luis is only about half full, 51% capacity. Local fishermen are absolutely beside themselves over this. Should politicians be alarmed? Should we be storing, saving more waters for dry years ahead? And will there be more dry years ahead? Obviously. But the question is, when? We don't know when. Live in our studio right now is Roger George. He is our resident expert on water, reservoirs, and his fishing knowledge, my friends, is off the charts. We're going to talk to him, take your phone calls, 436-ME-TV, option 11. We're back in just a moment.
The Justice Network is here. If you haven't tuned in, you're missing a great lineup of gripping stories of real crime, plus an unprecedented effort by viewers like you to play an active role in making your community safer. You can help support law enforcement by providing information that may lead to the apprehension of dangerous criminals or find a missing child. Great shows and your chance to fight crime, only on the Justice Network.
Tune in to Heartland for the best in true country music. Relive vintage specials, one-of-a-kind concerts, and country music's earliest videos. Heartland is the heart of country, the only place where you can find country music, country stars, and country lifestyles 24/7. Heartland, the heart of country.
Now on channel 13.2.
The new Frigidaire Professional line at Ventura TV Video Appliance. Enjoy generous-sized cooktops and sauté or simmer with ease, while true convection ovens offer even baking and juicy roasting perfection. Foods stay their freshest in spacious refrigerators with convenient controls and clear filtered ice and water. Easy-to-clean surfaces reduce fingerprints, and the quietest of dishwashers makes cleanup a snap. The new Frigidaire Professional line at Ventura TV Video Appliance.
All right, back here on the program, and Roger George is here. Good to see you, my friend. I guess you have a lot of reaction that you have simmering right down in here that you want to get out this morning based on our interview with Shane Hunt and all these releases. Let's take a quick phone call first. Go ahead, caller. You're on the air.
I have two questions for you. I like to watch these old westerns, and I was watching Big Valley, and there was a dispute over the water. The water was supposed to be coming down, but this one owner wanted to keep it from coming down to their ranch.
Yeah.
And there was a law on the books called pariety or something, parity, whatever it was. Does that still exist, and can we force the federal government with that law to start releasing that water from down there? And the second question I have, I hope you answer both questions, is where is all that water going that we're releasing from the lakes? If we're using it, that's one thing, but if we're dumping it out in the ocean, that's another.
Okay. Well, I'll try to answer your question. I'm not, when it comes to water law, I certainly am no expert, but I have seen information that in the early days here when they were building canals, because water was such a critical part of farming, that your ability to have a canal and the waterways that were built on the west side was, you know, critical to your farming success and to any success. And there were actually laws on the books, from what I understand, that had to do with controlling water from maybe the point of where your ranch was at and farther down. And I don't know the name of those laws, but I know that there were definitely some unusual laws that had to do with the early canal systems in the valley. Mm. So that was, you're on the right track. There were some unusual things, but you'd have to do a historical search on that to probably find out. Your second question is about where the water goes. We have two different facilities here. We have Millerton, and that water coming from that watershed is coming down, and that usually goes to the Fryant Authority users and some of the people on the west side too. So
Side's hardly getting any.
Yeah, they hardly, and as
like
you may
what,
have read,
5% allocation?
5%. They're getting literally nothing. So it's one of those things where that water is not going to the ocean, but it's going out to users. The other facility, which is San Luis Reservoir, that water typically is going down, and the word that Mr. Hunt used was exporting. That water is going to Los Angeles, you know, and I don't think they particularly like to tell everybody that, but that water is going to Los Angeles by the canal.
We have contracts that say we have to do that.
And yes, it has to be done, but they try to be really delicate about mentioning that. So we have a lot of water here that's going in that direction.
Yeah.
So I hope that answers your questions, but that's where the two flows of water typically end up.
Yeah. Well, let me ask you this, because here's the thing. I know that a lot of this water is going to farmers. That's what Shane Hunt told us.
Sure.
He's from the Bureau and talked to us on the phone here the last couple of minutes. But the question is, I mean, okay, Millerton is only at 64% capacity. In the last 10 days, that lake has dropped by 7 feet.
It's actually 11 feet. I checked it this morning. It dropped another 2 feet, so it's actually dropped a lot more than
in the last day or so, it's dropped another three feet. Okay, all right, I'm a little behind then on there, about a day or two behind then. During that same time period, more than 33,000 acre-feet of water has been released out of Millerton Lake.
Yes.
Is it necessary, in your opinion, to release that much water at this particular time, and do they have to prep for the snow melt?
Yeah, they need to prep for the snow melt. You know, what happens with water is that you get it in shots. You know, that's what happens. If we have a quick snow melt, then we could have possibly, you know, water coming down like crazy, and then it could go over the dam. So I understand what they're saying, because we have had that happen where it's flooded the San Joaquin River and been a problem. So they have to anticipate that if we had a super hot shot of weather, that would obviously melt a lot of snow. We'd have a lot of water at one shot. But right now, the thing that I think most of us are looking at is that we're already releasing. So a lot of our historic releases and flows of water are just really very different than they've been in the past. And normally at this point, we're filling that lake up. And, it's up much higher than this, you know, 3, 4, 5 years ago. So that's one of the things that people are wondering about. And like you said, storage. We're concerned about letting water out, even though, I mean, and obviously we're concerned about the farmers not getting anything after a good water year. That's kind of problematic.
Yeah, it is. And we ought to be using more storage. And even Shane admitted that to a certain extent, not full outright, but he did say we have some storage capability. But where is that storage? That's what I want to know. I mean, you know, here's the thing. The snowpack normally stores about 30% of all of California's water supply. So only about a third.
Yes.
Only about a third. So, yeah, that water's coming down, but it's only about a third of our state's water supply.
Yes.
So we can't be, should we be, the question is, should we be more conservative at this point as to how much water we're letting out?
Well, you know, and that's a great question because I've tried to get some answers on that too. And, you know, it's watching historical and some of the contracts they have, obviously, with ag. That's a difficult thing to work with. But like you say, we have all these different waterways. And Hunt, Mr. Hunt talked about the fact that you have Mammoth Pool, Shaver Lake. You have all these upriver, different reservoirs. And so you have storages, and they try to sometimes store the water up there and then start releasing it. But the question that I have is that we typically are already raising the levels, and at this point, the levels are already going down. So I'm wondering, like you said, from a storage standpoint, are they going to actually bring the levels back up again as the snowmelt hits? So
I asked them that question,
but they don't, and obviously he doesn't know the answer because they don't know how quickly it might hit. And so they're concerned about it. But, you know, at this point, I think the real issue is we have no extra storage. We're really kind of behind the eight ball. And this is a lack of planning. It's just been a lack of planning for a long time.
But this is an age-old problem, an age-old question.
It is.
An age-old angst between, you know, those that believe that we ought to serve the fish downstream and those that think, hey, the farmers need water, we need water, we need to store water. It's an age-old argument.
It's an old argument, but I think that what's happened is that we have been, and I'm going to say this because I believe it to be true. I believe that the ecologists, you know, in California have had the upper hand, and frankly, there was no new storage built after New Melones in 1984.
Yeah.
So there hasn't been any new storage capacities that have been put in place, and right now, the dams are so far out that our ability to store water, we're going to have to do some other creative things in the meantime to store water and restore our underground water system.
Yeah. Caller, you're on the line. Go ahead.
Yeah, my question is, does all this water crisis and everything like that, because, you know, as a consumer, I mean, and a homeowner, I know what I pay for my water. I mean, but is this money actually, I mean, is money the bottom line here? Because I know water right now, we're in a drought, so water must be going at a premium. You know what I mean? People that were making X amount last couple years ago are probably making more now if they own the water. I mean, does this whole thing, does somebody own this stuff? Because I'm pretty sure they don't give the water. I mean, they're not even giving the water away anymore. I mean, I go to my faucet, I got to pay every for, you know, through my meter. So ultimately, my question is it hard to do with dollars and cents? Because I'm pretty sure there's people out there that prefer us to be in a drought. I mean, they go on all the water. I mean, they'll better, instead of give it to the farmers, they'll give it to LA. That's my question.
Well, you know, I'll tell you, the sale of water, there's obviously been a lot of articles in the Fresno Bee about some of the different water stakeholders in this area that have actually, you know, looked at selling water. And there was a real outcry about that, selling some of it to Southern California. There's also been some question about that same thing happening up in the Delta with some interests up there that have bought islands or trying to buy islands in very key spots in the Delta. So, you know, no, the economic side of this thing is obviously very critical. And, you know, the cost of water it obviously drives what's going on. But I think that right at this point that, you know, having a good water year, the real issue, I think, is that we're all concerned because we're kind of going, gee, Merry Christmas, we got a lot of extra water. And yet at this point, it feels like we're still in the middle of the drought and that a lot of this is just going, it's wherever. We don't know. It's going different directions. And it's kind of like, oh, my gosh, are we going to have anything left when this is all done?
I've heard people say that this drought is man-made.
Well, obviously, we haven't had the storage, and, you know, one of the questions I would have asked Mr. Hunt was that with the Delta and with the amount of water that's going out to the ocean up there, because they got such a big shot of water in the Northern California area, that a lot of that couldn't be held, and it went over the dams, and so it had to be released as a flood release. And I had said this over a year ago. I said, you know, wouldn't it be ironic if we suddenly had a shot of water that was a big one, and which is the way it happens, and then we can't hold that water, and we got to put it out to the ocean because we didn't plan for that contingency.
And it happened.
And I think that that's a criminal. I think it's a criminal thing to not have the planning in place to store as much as you possibly can. And my question would be that why not take some of that water that's going to the ocean? It's not going to any stakeholders in the Delta. Why isn't more of that being diverted into San Luis Reservoir, for example? Build it up to the very top. Maybe there's some regs on that that the feds won't allow. But that's a question I think most everybody's asking.
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, I don't think he would have known. About that. It's an answer that doesn't come easily when you start questioning people about water, because there are so many contracts involved with the state and with the feds. It gets so complex. And for me to sit here and try to understand how the California or the Central Valley watershed works, it's too complex for anybody. You need a hydrologist or somebody to explain it so everybody can understand it properly. And then when you throw in the mix of contracts about who gets water, where, what, how much, man, it is a maze. It's a corn maze.
Well, and right now, like, for example, at San Luis, I talked to the superintendent over there, and we were talking about the water level over there at a million and 40,000 acre feet. Well, it's dropped about a foot and a half, which I was kind of surprised. But we were talking about that we're way down, that the reason why the water didn't go in there wasn't because we didn't have the water. It was because of the Delta smelt issue. And so they didn't want to pump more than a certain amount to come down the canal because of the Delta smelt in the pumps. So we're kind of been, hung up to dry with some situations here that are out of our control.
All right. Caller, go ahead. You're on the air.
Yes. I was calling about, I have a question. Why can't we build a series of drainage basins, large drainage basins, along the San Joaquin River at intervals? A lot of the water coming, let's say, for example, the Frying Dam would fill up these basins. These basins, of course, would have spillways down the river to the next basin and the next basin. And you could store a whole lot of water on those basins. And also you could plant fish if people want to fish there. But basically it would be used for irrigation and be used to restore the aquifer, the underground aquifer.
Well, your question is way too much common sense, for the politicians, because I've talked about that for the last 3 years and written articles about it, that earthen dams could be put together very quickly, are very inexpensive, could hold a considerable amount of money, water. But the issue has once again come back to, environmental reports and all those types of things, which should be swept away, I believe, in the face of what we're trying to do here. There is no reason why we couldn't do exactly what you're talking about, because there are no other short-term solutions other than put it into some of the underground storage systems they have. But those are limited. And like you said, that would be one way to hold. And if we could even hold a half a million acre feet more of water and hold it in those kinds of facilities, it would have a large impact. That's a lot of water.
Yeah.
That was a great question.
Okay, thank you. Cut it off, please. Thank you very much. I appreciate your time and your call. 436-ME-TV, option 11. We're back here on the program after this from Charles Chuck McGill. He is our sponsor.
Have you or a loved one recently been arrested for a serious crime?
Is your professional reputation at risk?
Aggressive representation from a qualified defense attorney can help you avoid conviction and keep your reputation untarnished.
Hi, I'm Charles McGill, and I'll fight for your rights. With extensive experience in successfully defending against a wide range of criminal offenses and high-profile cases, you can rest assured that you'll get the fair trial you deserve from McGill Guzman McGill. Call us at 559-255-3425 or visit us online at toplawyersfresno.com.
The new Frigidaire Professional line at Ventura TV Video Appliance. Enjoy generous-sized cooktops and sauté or simmer with ease, while true convection ovens offer even baking and juicy roasting perfection. Foods stay their freshest in spacious refrigerators with convenient controls and clear filtered ice and water. Easy-to-clean surfaces reduce fingerprints, and the quietest of dishwashers makes cleanup a snap. The new Frigidaire Professional line at Ventura TV Video Appliance.
Back here on the program, Charles Chuck McGill is our sponsor today. By the way, tomorrow's program is a taped version of this Connect With Me show on MeTV Fresno. We'll have Kev in the building here. We taped a show with him earlier in the week. He is Kev Orkin. He is that musician, that comic from England that came here last week and performed at the Warner's Theater. So he was here in the studio for the entire hour, and we have an in-depth conversation and interview with him coming up tomorrow on the program. So we won't be able to take any phone calls because we actually won't be here. It'll be a tape program. Then we're back live on Monday with Dennis Hart. And then on Tuesday, Mike DeManuel Jr. will be here to talk about his insurance company, and he'll talk about politics. He'll be a first-time guest. And I don't know who's beyond that. We'll have to check on that later this week and tell you about the following week in terms of guests, Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday. All right, caller, you're on the air with Roger George. Go ahead.
Okay, I like to surf the net, and I found a site where they have actually been able to make water without the high explosion method. And I'm wondering, why can't we build ourselves a plant to construct water? I don't know how much it would cost, but it certainly would be worthwhile. And with this new development, there's no reason why we couldn't take it all away and build that plant.
Well, you know, I have not seen that, so I don't know. I can't speak much from experience. But, you know, of course, the big issue that's been thrown out has been desalinization. And the plant that's being
very, costly, though,
very,
right?
Very costly, you know, but the Israelis, for example, have done it very successfully.
I know.
You know, if we got to that point, I would certainly like to think that desalinization would be an adjunct, you know, that we could use in addition to what we have if that became necessary. But, you know, at this point, I would like to think that, like the prior caller, that you know, water, the way water happens is that it does not come you know, levelly throughout a year. It comes in big shots, and our ability to store water, it seems that if we had had the water in storage that we have put out to the sea over the last decade, it's a considerable amount. And we've had years where you see the San Joaquin River just flowing like crazy, and that water is going out. So, you know, I think that the first priority would be to create storage, and then if we see that we have a drought situation where we don't have storage, well, then, you know, then we're going to have to go to something else here to maintain it, and maybe we can stop building all kinds of developments and all this that we know are going to take huge amounts of water to maintain.
Yeah. See, we need to bring you on more often because you're generating so much interest, so many calls. We have another call. Caller, you're on the line with Roger George. See how popular you are, Roger?
I'll tell you what.
Go ahead.
I just like to say, if he caught himself with not this caller, but the earlier caller, when he was talking about building those along the San Joaquin, he did say you'll be able to store more money, and then he corrected himself and said water. I think that's the whole issue here.
As long as there's money to be made
on water,
that's a good case.
We're never going to get rid of this drought. We're never going to get rid of this drought. I mean, there's money to be made.
I can't get away with anything.
As a Freudian slip, but yeah, I caught it.
There you go.
But yeah, as long as there's money to be made on water here in California, I don't think we're ever going to take care of this problem. I mean, there's issues that we don't know. I mean, they might just want us to go drought here so they can export or import foreign produce. I mean, I've already seen that already. I've seen congressmen already saying that that's what they want to do. That's their next step. Or the San Joaquin Valley can't have it anymore. Well, let's import fruit from somewhere else. I mean, they're already going that way. I don't think it's right.
Yeah,
But that's just my statement. Thank you.
Hey, well, thank you very much. That was a good catch, caller, because I caught that too, but I didn't say anything.
You know,
I just wanted to see.
John tries to get me every time, so that's okay.
That was not a plant, by the way.
Okay, well, that's pretty good. Well, you know, another topic here that I just would have to throw out that I was thinking about just a second ago is we've talked about water, and we had an issue earlier about talking about, well, what about the fish and all that? And you know what's amazing is that the fish, during this drought period, have done very well And we've been lucky. We've been able to manage it. And this year, with this water coming back in and all that, the fish situation is wonderful. The fish are doing very well. When they have more water, biologically, they come back pretty darn quick. Mother Nature is an amazing thing. So anyhow, that's something that is not as big of a problem right now as it had been.
Well, I was going to say, this videotape is probably so old, that fish is probably dead by now, but that's okay. It's not a problem.
We got some spawning salmon right there. Yeah.
Yeah. But who knows when this was taken. But see, another call generated here on Connect With Me by Roger George. We're talking about water, a very important topic here, and it outrages a lot of people. And, you know, it got my attention, too, as to when you showed me the releases on the internet, I was flabbergasted.
I was shocked a week and a half ago when I saw the first releases. I was going like, already.
My body is still in shock. So we've got all this rain. What are you doing? Why are you releasing that water? Caller, go ahead. You're on the air.
You know, I got to get back to this question. You broke the ground 35 years ago. Why is it going to take another 20 years to solve this problem? We can't wait 20 years. We voted on more water, and this isn't the first time we've done the voting. We did it last time. They spent the money on any old thing they could find. When are we going to get together and let's fix this problem?
Let me ask you a question. Go ahead and keep her up there. I want to ask you a question. Are the environmentalists killing us? Are they killing the state of California?
Yes. We have Agenda 21. Put out by the UN. They want to take the whole entire United States and turn it back into a wilderness, concentrate the population into 6 megacities, reducing the population of the United States from 315 million down to 66 million, and then charges up the wazoo for a little itty-bitty space to live in. Yes. We are being forced into a drought situation by cutting off the water supply from the top. We never on this earth ever had this problem before. We've had plenty of droughts, but we went right straight through them because we had that water coming down. They cut it off, and they used the excuse of the fish, the little smelt, which weren't a native and died off anyway, you know? Agenda 21.
Interesting perspective there, Roger.
I don't know about some of the other things. Like I said here, it sounds like you got some things, other things there that are secondary issues that I really don't want to necessarily encompass.
Delve into,
because I'm not an expert.
Yeah.
But when it comes to the water situation, no, this has been going on for a long time. And like I was saying before, we haven't built one single acre foot of new storage since 1984 in California.
Well, shouldn't this make it more urgent to build temperance flat?
The dams are going to be obviously important, but we have a very pressing problem right now. And like the gentleman said before, is we need to come up with something that's a more mobile, quick strike kind of a strategy here that we can actually store water today. And so it would make a big difference, I think.
All right. Caller, you're on the air. Go ahead.
Yeah, you asked the lady before me here about if the environmentalists were killing us.
Yeah.
And I agree. They are. I worked for the lumber industry. And we got shut down because of the spotted owl.
Certainly.
At the time.
Oh, yeah, I remember that.
Now, my uncle, who is an ornithologist, author and studies birds, studied the spotted owl, and it's a shy bird. It's not going to stick around so you can count it. Okay? For
I'm kind
one.
Of shy too, Roger. I,
and two, the smelt, if there, why, what is a smelt?
Well, you know, this
thank
is
you for that call.
That's a good question. The smelt situation, is something that is problematic. There's a lot of people that feel that, you know, that the people that study this are often...
There it is right there. Is that the smelt?
That's the smelt right there.
Okay.
You know, they feel that that a lot of times that these studies that have been done have been done improperly, that the scientific method they've used has been way out of line. And what's interesting, my question to some of the biologists that I've talked to has been that, okay, so we have a delta smelt, and they're basically saying they're almost extinct right now. It's interesting because if that's such a critical part of the food chain, my question to them, which is just an honest question, would be, well, why is it that the striped bass, the bass, the largemouth bass, crappie, sturgeon, why are all of those fisheries literally, they've been off the scale, they've been so good this year? What I have found in the years that of fishing, I have found that fisheries can totally change, that fish can change their habitat, what they feed upon, and obviously they're doing that.
They can, depending upon nature?
They can do it because they can change their entire food source. And we see that happening in San Luis right now with the striped bass. They're on shrimp right now, which is a new source. So there's a lot of new things going on here that I think that have changed the formula, but yet we're still dealing with it as if it's a single unilateral issue.
Go, caller, you're on the air. Limited time, though, limited time.
Hey, one more time, I'm gonna tell you, we built the Panama Canal, and the Kings River's dry. There's no reason why the river's dry. We built the Panama Canal, and it should work.
All right.
We can bring water from everywhere.
Okay.
And I don't know what the holdup is. Later.
Yeah, I've heard that.
Politics.
Yeah, that caller has called before on previous shows talking about the Panama Canal. Oh, it's true. Yeah. How come we can build the Panama Canal? We can cut through, but we can't build Temperance Flat. Yeah.
Unfortunately, now that we have a little bit of water, the political pressure is off, and so what people do is they kind of back up again.
Yeah. Hey, before we go to break, I want to put up the rain totals. Let's put up that graphic, full screen of the rain totals. This, according to our friends and good friends, and we've become good friends with the people at the National Weather Service over there in Hanford. A big shout out to those guys if they're watching. My friend Kevin Lenat over there, he's a good guy. He's going to come back on the show. You got to get to know him, Roger. He's a good guy. Yeah. Look at that. January, 4.42. February, 0.33. But then we came back in March, so we're kind of above the norm right now for the last 3 months. It's not bad, but we've got to still have to, that doesn't mean we can waste water. We still have to conserve. Is that what you're trying to tell us?
I don't think we're out of the woods. And I think that the biggest problem we have now is the underwater, underground water system. That's going to become a giant issue. I mean, people are aware of it, but that's our future. That's our bank. And we're draining a lot of it out of it. It's got to be dealt with.
Yeah. You know, just looking at those rain totals, I wish for the next 3 months we'd get the same amount of rain. Wouldn't that be nice?
That'd be nice. We have a possibility of some rain here in the next couple of days. I don't know if it's much. But the other thing that helps a little bit is if you have cooler weather coming in here, rain clouds and all that, it definitely keeps the, transpiration and all that down. Yeah. So.
Anyway, we got to take a break. Roger George is here. I'm glad he's here. He's an expert in the world of fishing and water. And I'll tell you, nobody does it better than Roger. 436 BTV, option 11, Charles Chuck McGill, our sponsor today. When we come back, we're going to show you those graphics of how much water they're releasing both from San Luis and from Millerton. So hang on to your seats. I hope you're sitting down. Back in a moment.
Tune in to Heartland for the best in true country music. Relive vintage specials, one-of-a-kind concerts, and country music's earliest videos. Heartland is the heart of country, the only place where you can find country music, country stars, and country lifestyles 24/7. Heartland, the heart of country.
Now on channel 13.2.
Have you or a loved one recently been arrested for a serious crime?
Is your professional reputation at risk?
Aggressive representation from a qualified defense attorney can help you avoid conviction and keep your reputation untarnished.
Hi, I'm Charles McGill, and I'll fight for your rights. With extensive experience in successfully defending against a wide range of criminal offenses and high-profile cases, you can rest assured that you'll get the fair trial you deserve from McGill Guzman McGill. Call us at 559-255-3425 or visit...
Back here on the program, as promised, let's check out some of those releases. Let's start with Millerton Lake, and I want you to leave these graphics up here. Okay, Roger. Okay, the reason we got to leave these up here, just leave them up on the screen because we need to fully explain what we're looking at. Okay, on 329, Millerton had about 352,000 acre feet of water, but then they made the releases, and then on 41, it went down to 342. and then on down the line, and look at the releases on April the 5th. 4,946 acre-feet of water. Leave that up there so we can dissect it. Okay, go ahead and comment on what we're looking at here.
Well, you know, we reached the apex of the height of the water in San Luis at on the 29th of March.
This is Millerton, by the way.
Millerton, I'm looking hard here. So at that point, that's when they started actually releasing. And what you've got at Millerton is you have two factors. One is you have an input of water coming in from the upper end of Millerton, and then you have releases that are on the other end. So what we're seeing here is the net difference between what's coming in and what's going out. And so what we're seeing here is we have a negative 4,096 acre feet of water that is going, you know, is being taken out of the system. So we have, you know, approximately running at 4,000 acre feet here on a regular basis going on for the last, you know, almost 2 weeks, 2.5 weeks. So
we've lost 22,000 or more than 22,000 acre feet of water just in the last 10 days. And see, that's not even updated. That's only through April the 5th. This is April the 7th, so we didn't calculate April the 6th and 7th. Yeah. So we don't know what's happening yet today, but it's an alarming figure. And what we need to do is take the inflows and compare how much is coming in. But here's the question I had for Shane Hunt from the Bureau of Reclamation, and I didn't quite understand the answer. Why can't they keep Millerton or San Luis? San Luis is only half full. Why can't they keep that level at like 70-80% and manage the flows coming down?
Yes.
You mean to tell me they can't do that?
Yeah, they can do it.
Well, then why don't they?
And that would be my question to him too. But
I asked it two or three times and he didn't answer.
Well, you know, once again, it's a deal where they're concerned about snow melt happening very quickly. That if we got a period of 100 degree weather, that they suddenly would have a flood event that might occur. So I think that they're kind of concerned about that, but. You know, if you look back historically at this lake, normally at this time of the year, they're bringing it up. You know, they're bringing this level up continually. So they're really, they've kind of changed, let's put it this way, strategically, they've changed the way that they're handling the water at this point.
Do you believe they'll bring the water up on both of these reservoirs once that snowpack melts?
I certainly hope so, because if not, then what we're going to do is we're going to have another mud hole at the end of the year.
Were you satisfied with his answer? On that?
No, not particularly. No. I would have liked to ask him a lot more because if they had the hydrologist, they could tell us that they have so many thousand acre feet that are above.
All right, only 2 minutes left. Let's put up the San Luis numbers from the reservoir over there. And you're a regular over there. We went over there fishing with you. That's the acre feet of water. It's a much bigger reservoir, obviously, than Millerton. It holds more than 1 million acre feet of water. Here are some of the releases. Again, pretty alarming. You know, what's to say that they're not going to stop this kind of behavior? I don't know. And how much is coming in?
Well, what's alarming here, John, is that we are not nearly as high. I talked to superintendent yesterday, and we're not nearly as high as what we thought we would get to store it. And the reason why was because the Delta smelt at the pumps up in the Delta. They were only going to put, they only brought in so much water. And in the time that they had, they were pumping in. So what's problematic here is that we really don't have the storage in there that we should have at this point traditionally.
We got a minute left. San Luis should be not at 51% capacity, but what?
Oh, it should be at least up around 65, 70. So we should be at 1.5 million, 1.6 million, 1.7 million. Even in drought years, we have it up at that level. So what they've done here is we've cut our nose off to spite our face, and it's because of the Delta smelt that they're telling us that's the situation.
Irritating.
Most of the water that's being taken out of San Luis right now is going over the hill. It's not going down at Los Angeles. It's going to Gilroy Watsonville.
Yeah, see, it's just it's irritating to say the least. And so, Roger, we got to go.
Yes, sir.
But I don't want to get cut off, but you're going to come back at some point.
Absolutely. We'll talk about the fish next time.
Yeah, talk about the fish, and we'll show some photos. And I really appreciate your time.
Hey.
You know that.
Hey, you
know
it.
You're a good friend.
Hey,
you got to get to know those folks over there at the National Weather Service. They're good people. Good guys over there. Anyway, see you tomorrow, actually on tape with Kev Orkian. He's a comic. He's a musician. We're back live on Monday with Dennis Hart. Tuesday, Mike Dermanuel Jr. Have a wonderful, safe weekend. Watch tomorrow's tape show. pesky